There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it?
Good morning, everybody. And I want to encourage you to wear a mask. If you're ill, put a mask on. It will protect those around you. If you're with people who are ill, wear a mask. It'll protect you. I am going to take mine off because I'm not ill. Because Sam Becker, who's operating the camera, is more than 6 foot away from me. I'm grateful to Sam for assisting us in this. We'd invite you to visit his website. We need to be keeping 6 foot away from each other. That's what social distancing is. But if you can, please rather stay at home at this time. The coronavirus is only just now arriving in our town, and the governor tells us we will only see its results within the next few weeks. Let me, however, make one thing clear. We will continue to trust God with our lives and with the life of our world. Having spoken of the sensible things we need to do to be safe, let me remind us of the words of Psalm 23, that God accompanies us even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And we will fear no evil, because as the psalmist says, Thou art with us, Thy rod, Thy staff, they comfort us, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so I light a candle. A reminder that we are coming into a time of worship. I light a candle as a reminder that even when the darkness gathers, the light of Christ shines in the darkness, and the darkness has never put it out. Certainly the events of the past few weeks have overtaken us. 3 weeks ago, we moved out of these buildings into your homes, and at that time we thought we could continue to live stream from the church buildings, and we gathered musicians. We had an amazing service with an empty church. But it's become clear that it's no longer safe to gather our musicians, so our music is pre-recorded so that we can all be safe. I do want to greet those who have joined us on the internet, and thank you for joining us. It really makes no difference that we're sitting in front of a computer. All of us can join together to worship God, who is everywhere. A couple of weeks ago, I said, God doesn't live in a building. So let us recognize that God is in our homes, and God is in our town, and in our land, and in our world. We will sing, we will pray, we will read from Scripture, and we will be comforted by God. Can I just add one or two church notices? We want to reach out to those who are shut in and needing help, even if that help is just a phone call to hear a human voice. You can leave messages on our phone at the office and we'll pick them up, or those who know Brenda Heap can contact her. She's coordinating that ministry within our church. Would you please continue to support us financially? I'm so grateful to those who have contributed. Our banking details will appear on the screen at the end of the service. And then to remind us that this week is Holy Week, we will have services. We'll have services on Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night, and there will be Holy Communion on Sunday morning. Please go to our website. All the details will appear there. We are also going to send out a letter to the whole congregation about how we on Sunday can join together with the congregation, which will include joining us on radio or joining us on the internet. And so we're going to sing, we're going to pray, and we're going to remember the light of Christ that is with us.
Let us bow our heads and our hearts as we enter into a moment of prayer together. O God, we come before you today, hesitant and uncertain, our hearts filled with reluctant hope, hope that wants to reach for the light rather than wallowing in the darkness. Like a flower leaning toward the sunlight, we yearn for your light and your love. During this time of pandemic, social distancing, and isolation, we pray that your holy light will show us a way through the darkness. Open our eyes to see your light, to see the positivity in the world, and embolden us to be strong and courageous in the face of discouragement. Holy Lord, we especially lift up those on the front lines of this pandemic, and we pray that you will strengthen them and provide for them as they care for us. Please wrap this church and community in your loving arms and give us the peace we need during these times of struggle. And now we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I will be sharing two scripture readings today. The first comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, and it is the 10th commandment. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. And now from Matthew, chapter 21, verses 9 through 16. The crowds walking in front of Jesus and those walking behind began to shout, Praise to David's son. God bless him who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise be to God. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was thrown into an uproar. Who is he? The people asked. This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee, the crowds answered. Jesus went into the temple and drove out all those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the stools of those who sold pigeons and said to them, It is written in the scriptures that God said, My temple will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a hideout for thieves. The blind and the crippled came to him in the temple, and he healed them. The chief priests and the teachers of the law became angry when they saw the wonderful things he was doing, and the children shouting in the temple, Praise to David's son. So they asked Jesus, Do you hear what they are saying? Indeed I do, answered Jesus. Haven't you ever read this scripture? You have trained children and babies to offer perfect praise. Here ends the reading of our Holy Scripture. Would you pray with me? And now, Lord, may you strengthen and guide Pastor Pete so that his words point our hearts and our minds to you and only you. Amen.
We are in the final week of Lent. Who would have thought 6 weeks ago when we embarked on this Lenten journey, where I invited us to give up something for Lent, who would have thought that the thing we're giving up is our freedom of movement? We have used the Ten Commandments as a framework for Lent. And today we come to the end of our study. We look at the 10th commandment. I have invited us to see these not as rules intended to crush us, but rather as being aspirational, an invitation to live a better way. And so the 10th commandment, do not covet. Probably a more modern translation would be, do not desire what others have. Basically, don't look over at your neighbor's yard and want what they've got. Which kind of links with last week's commandment about stealing. Because wanting your neighbor's stuff is the first step in our head that can lead to taking your neighbor's stuff. But as we've learned by now, Jesus' approach to the Ten Commandments was to take the negative commandment and discover it in the positive. And so in this way, do not covet, when read in the positive, becomes be satisfied with what you have. And let me just note, it's a little more complicated than that. Being happy with what I have is not saying that I cannot strive for something better. Being happy with what I have doesn't mean that I can't set goals and work hard to achieve them. It speaks to the envy that is in my heart. Envy for what other people have that prevents me from seeing the blessings that God has given me. This speaks to that gut-turning, angry, wishing that I had whatever they have, whoever they might be. You see, God has blessed each one of us. And this commandment invites us to learn to live with the blessings I've received, rather than wishing for the blessings somebody else has received. But as I've looked at this commandment, and as I've filtered it through the fact that today is Palm Sunday, I discover that this story, the Palm Sunday story, and the 10th commandment have this one thing in common. It speaks to the way I can flaunt the stuff I have so as to create envy in the minds of other people. I want to go back to the story of Jesus going to the temple on Palm Sunday, which is a story of people creating an environment for spiritual and social envy. You see, life in the temple was divided into two halves. There were the haves and there were the have-nots. The haves were those who were allowed through the door of the temple. These were people who could pray, who could join in singing the hymns, be part of the social groups and the various decision-making bodies about the life of the people of Israel. The haves, who brought the offerings, who loved being in the temple, who were part of the life of the nation. And then the have-nots, the rest, who were contemptuously called the Am Ha'aretz by those who were allowed through the door. Those who had the advantage looked down on their nose at those who did not, who were the people who were too poor to afford to buy an offering, who were the people who could not get through the door because they were ill or disfigured in some way, and therefore not perfect enough to worship God, who were the people who were not welcome in the social groups and the important decision-making processes because they were from another culture or from another language. So they sat at the door wishing that they could go in. They sat at the door begging those who were lucky enough to go in to offer prayers on their behalf. They sat at the door envying those lucky people who made it through the door of the temple. And obviously sat at the door committing the sin of coveting. And I can hear the self-righteous people walking through the door, lifting their religious noses and whispering about the sinners who gathered at the door. And what Jesus does next is shocking. You see, Jesus addresses the sin of covetousness, but he doesn't preach to the sinners who are sitting on the steps of the temple. Instead, he removes the barriers that prevents these sinners from entering the temple. He moved the offering tables and the money-changing tables and all those other things that prevented these poor sinners from feeling like they were welcome in God's house. He moved them aside and he said to the sinners, come into my father's house. We read Matthew 21:14. Listen what happened. The blind and the crippled came to Jesus in the temple and he healed them. The people who'd been sitting on the steps came in and they found Jesus inside and they discovered God's healing, loving embrace. Jesus literally took their envy away from them. He showed them that they had no need to covet anymore. He allowed them to discover they were God's beloved. And the moment they discovered they were God's beloved, their envy dissipated. Which I think is the key to all of our envy. We only envy when we don't believe that we are God's beloved. I want what another person has because I think that it will somehow make me happier or more satisfied or more important. The fact is, we can own all the wealth in the world and still not have enough. I've seen billionaires looking over the wall of their neighbor and saying, "Why haven't I got one of those?" I recently heard a billionaire saying, "Why haven't I got a Nobel Prize?" You see, the key to losing our envy of other people is to receive the love of God into our hearts. Once I discover I'm God's beloved, I don't need to be envious of anyone else because I have received all the blessings in creation. But at the same time, I would fail us. I'd fail us if I did not challenge us to learn the lesson of Palm Sunday, to beware of the barriers that I place in the way of other people around me. I need to be asking, who is sitting at the door of our religious institutions? Whom am I shutting out while I bask in the love of God? And our history as religious people is not good. We were the ones who left slaves sitting on the doorstep outside of our churches. We men were the ones who said to women, "Stay silent," while we bask in the love of God. We left children outside in children's areas while the grown-ups got on with the real worship of God. And it's still a temptation. It's still a temptation to leave the illiterate and the poor and the gay people and the refugees in the car park. Jesus opened the door of the temple so that all could enter. What will we do today? But let me close. I'm going to use a video because sometimes we hear better with our ears and with our eyes. So why don't you take a look at this video and allow it to speak to your heart and allow you to hear this Palm Sunday message afresh.
I was there the day that Jesus walked into the temple. He just stood there at first, almost as in disbelief. And then I saw it. I saw that fire growing in his eyes. I'd come from Galilee to the place where God said he'd meet us. Did it feel like a scam? Yeah. I was never able to afford a lamb for my sacrifice, so I had to settle for one of those overpriced pigeons. As a young wife and mother, there's a word you never expect to be called. Widow. I didn't realize how safe I'd felt with my husband around until he was gone. And then it just felt like being exposed on every side with nothing in between your babies and a world of vipers. But me, just me. So I stood there that day in the temple and I watched as Jesus grabbed a whip and drove those businessmen out of the temple, poured their money on the ground. But more than that, there was something about the expression on his face. I recognized it. He swung that whip like vipers were threatening his kids. He said, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Took me 3 years to figure out what he meant. Slow learner. He wasn't talking about the building. That was a place where dishonest men put their grimy fingerprints all over God's glory. They defiled the intimate process of worshiping him. That day wasn't about destruction. It was about hope. Because now, knowing God is all about Jesus. As I think about that day back in the temple, and I remember what Jesus did and how he did it, it felt like being rescued. Life can still be brutal. My kids' appetites are still growing. I still cry a lot. But he made a place for me to be still, where rest and trust meet right there at God's feet. And the price of that access, it's paid because of Jesus. He conquered death, and that's how I make it through life.
So the question: who is sitting at the door of our religious institutions? Join me in a prayer as we pray that we can become welcoming people. Let us pray. Lord God, we are so grateful that you have loved us. You've loved us so much that you sent your Son, Jesus, to come and live amongst us. We pray that the love we receive in our hearts might overflow to those around us, that we might discover capacity to love even those whom society might deem to be unlovely. May we be known for the quality of our welcome. And where there are barriers, may we work to removing those barriers at the doors of our churches. May we here in Brookings truly become the church at the corner of community. And may our community know that they are welcome to walk through our doors because there are no barriers. We will welcome everyone because of your love for us. So go with us into this week, and may we extend your love and your compassion and your kindness. For that is the work of Jesus, for Christ's sake. Amen. And so we're going to sing. We sing a song that speaks of the love of Jesus, that reminds us that we are God's beloved and that we seek to love others.
You are here. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
You are
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every life. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
So thank you for joining us. It's just been wonderful to have this sense all over town that people are gathering. In closing, can I invite us to remember three things? First of all, remember to donate to the ministry and the work of our church. Details will be on the screen. We are grateful to those who have responded. Secondly, I do want us to remember that we who follow Jesus have been raised up for a time such as this. Joshua 1 verse 9 says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." So let us be the ones who stand steady in this time of crisis. Number one. Number two, The third, remember? Do you guys remember what it is? Remember to wear your masks. Remember to keep your social distance. Remember to wash your hands. I'm grateful to those musicians who got together a week or two ago to pre-record the songs we used in our service. And now I will bless you and pray that you in turn can become a blessing for others. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and may the all-embracing sense of God's Spirit be with us and hold us and accompany us through this time. In Christ's name, amen. Amen.